building that muscle of good software design really is kind of the overarching goal of this whole thing.
Machines are so fast and stores are so big that they give us plenty of latitude to screw things up.
The shell, or which is the name we give to the command interpreter.
So the operator got a pair of tweezers and very carefully fished the moth out of the relay.
Because you've all read The Mythical Man Month.
And the best motivator in the world for programming is scratching your itch.
Developers, 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 developers.
Hello and welcome to another edition of the Sourcecraft Podcast. My name is Byung, and on this show, we talk with the people behind amazing dev tools and developer experience. Open source authors, maintainers, DevX engineers inside forward-thinking companies, developer advocates and educators, founders of DevTool companies, anyone and everyone who brings joy and delight into our lives as programmers. We talk about their work, we talk about their lives, we talk about their vision of what lies ahead for the world of code. Stay tuned. All right, I'm here with Kirsten Westeinde. Kirsten is a software development manager at Shopify, where I understand, Kirsten, you've been involved in a years-long effort to decompose Shopify's massive Rails monolith, or perhaps like multiple monoliths now, into smaller modular components. Is that right?
That's right.
Cool. Thanks so much for, you know, taking the time. I'm sure this sounds like a massive effort, and I'll bet that Shopify engineering has been very busy over the past year. So I really appreciate you taking the time to come chat with us and share things that you've learned along the way.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
So I think the focal point of our conversation is really going to be this massive decomposition effort. It's going to be like very fascinating to hear about, because I think a lot of engineering teams try to undertake projects like this, especially as the company grows, and some succeed, but a lot end in failure. And so I think you have a lot to share in terms of how you can pull this off successfully. But before we dive into all that, we have kind of a tradition on the podcast of first asking people, you know, how they got into programming. You know, right now you're this software development manager who's in charge of this, you know, very complex project. You have a lot of responsibility, but at some point, you know, you had your first contact with code. So, you know, for you, what was that, and how did that start your journey into this, you know, world of bits and ones and zeros that we live in?
Absolutely. Yeah. If you had asked me when I was a kid, I definitely would not have thought that this would have been where I ended up. I actually didn't even really know what programming was before I went into university, but I did end up studying engineering just because of my love for math and science. And the school that I went to ended up doing a general first year where we basically took classes from all of the different engineering tracks to kind of learn a bit about them and decide where we wanted to go. And so in my first year, I took a programming class. We learned C++, and it turns out that I really enjoyed it and I was really good at it. And the more that I looked into it, it seemed like a really interesting field to be in. So I had originally thought I would be a civil engineer, but I'm very glad that I ended up going the direction I did.
Wow, C++, that's kind of like diving off the deep end as your kind of like first programming language.
Yeah. It's always funny to hear what people learn in school. It's rarely what we end up using in the field, I find.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So from your start in university, what was kind of like the rough journey from there to joining Shopify?
I actually joined Shopify as an intern while I was still in school.
Oh, okay.
So I did two internships with other companies, but I joined Shopify in 2013 out of the Ottawa office as an intern. And then I ended up doing three different internships with Shopify before joining full-time after I graduated. And throughout those internships, I really used the time to try out different things and try to understand where my interests lay. So I did some web development using Rails. I did some mobile development, and I worked on some internal tools and external products. So I've really had my hands in a lot of different places at Shopify over the years.
Awesome. So you've been there since 2013, which means you've kind of had like a front row seat to this whole like rocket ship trajectory that the company's been on.
Yeah, it's been crazy. Like when I joined, I think we had 150 people working for the company, and we were a private company. We had only a handful of merchants. We had one small office. And fast forward to today, we're an international company. We have it's hard to keep track of, but I think like 7,000 plus employees at this time. We're a public company. So much has changed. I like to tell people I haven't worked at the same company for 7-8 years. I've actually worked at like 8 different companies because it really has been changing that quickly.
Yeah, that's crazy. And, you know, I bet most of our listeners don't need any introduction to Shopify, but, you know, for the one or two people who've been living under a rock for the past 7 years, chances are if you bought anything on the internet, chances are you've used Shopify, right? Because you power a lot of the kind of small businesses and independent operators that sell things online, right?
Yeah, that's correct. We actually like don't force the Shopify brand on our merchant site. So a lot of people buy things from Shopify stores without actually knowing that they have. But basically, if you bought something off Amazon and it was a enjoyable, or sorry, off anything other than Amazon, and it was an enjoyable experience, it was probably a Shopify store.
Yeah. And actually, for me personally, increasingly, I find myself buying more and more things off Amazon because there's like, a lot of times the things that you can get in these kind of independent stores are just like higher quality, or it just feels closer to like the seller. And so thank you for enabling all that. So, you know, diving into this large scale refactoring and re-architecture project, I thought, you know, maybe we could start off by giving people an overview of what Shopify looks like as an engineering organization and as a code base. So, you know, in broad strokes, what are the, you know, major teams and what are the major parts of the code, and what does it all kind of do as an engineering system?
Definitely. So we talk about the core Shopify product as the core code base. And so that's basically what powers merchants to manage their orders, to manage shipping, et cetera. So like all the kind of core pieces of the product live in one Rails code base. Mm-hmm. And it's actually one of the largest, probably the largest Rails code base on the planet, because we got started with Rails like right when Rails became a thing. And it's been under continuous development since at least 2006. And the last time I checked, we're pushing like 3 million lines of code, more than 500,000 lifetime commits, and about 40,000 files. So it's massive. And in terms of an engineering org, I think we're at about 1,500 or so engineers. And we're actually aiming to hire another 2,021 this year. So it'll be continuing on this massive pace of growth. And if I had to guess, I'd guess probably about half of the engineering team works daily in the core code base, and the other half works on applications outside of core.
That's crazy. That's so much code. Have you gotten to the point where Git operations start to slow down at all? Like if you're to clone the entire code base to your local machine, like do people even do that, or, you know, how long does that take?
Yeah, people do it. It works. The test suite definitely can get slow, but development itself is not a problem. We always joke, like we host Kylie Jenner's shop on Shopify, and it's like one of the largest stores.
Yeah.
And we joke that like we are the Kylie to so many other systems that we use. So we're hosted on Google Cloud, and like we are by far the largest product hosted on Google Cloud. And so we're often stretching the boundaries of their systems. And similarly, like with Rails itself, we are often the ones that find those bugs that you only find when you're operating at this scale. And so what we do is we really make choices about what technologies we want to use and then really double down on them. So we actually have a full team at Shopify who are Rails core contributors, and we try to actually just evolve the tools that we use to be better and to be better able to support us and others.
What languages are in use? So, you know, Rails, I assume, you know, Ruby is a big language. Are there any others that are big parts of the stack?
Yeah, Shopify has always been very opinionated about technology choices. Mm. So essentially any problem that can be solved with Ruby on Rails should be. There are some exceptions if applications have really, really high performance constraints or need parallelization. Sometimes we use Go. The front ends are in React. And for mobile development, we've just standardized around React Native going forward as well. Mm-hmm. And then in data land, we have some Python and Scala. And in infrastructure, we have Go and Lua as well.
So you wrote this blog post about how you were in charge of this project to kind of decompose Shopify's main, you know, Ruby on Rails monolith into smaller modular components, not microservices, but different modularized components. We'll get into that later. Tell us at a high level, what was the mandate of that project, and how did you come to be involved in that?
Yeah. So I think it was around early 2017, it was becoming very clear that our core code base was reaching kind of a tipping point where it was becoming more and more challenging to build functionality into it because of all of the interdependencies. So projects were taking longer, adding things that used to be simple were causing test failures and big headaches. And also it was really, we were finding it really challenging to onboard new people into the code base because there was just so much to learn. And so we knew we had all of these problems, but we didn't want to get too into solutioning without really understanding what the problems were. So we actually sent out a large survey to all the engineers working in the core code base to hear their feedback about what the pain points were before deciding what to do. And it was that survey that actually led us to start this project. We originally called it a very clever name of break core up into multiple pieces. But that name eventually evolved into componentization, where essentially we wanted to make this one large code base feel like many smaller code bases. And so we wanted to separate the code by business domain, basically, because that is the code that more often needs to change together. And so what that would mean is if we were hiring someone onto, say, the shipping team, they should be able to just understand the shipping component without having to understand all of the other elements of the core code base. So at a high level, that was the goal.
Got it. So if I were a buzzword-driven engineering manager and you came to me and said, like, you know, let's decompose this monolith into, you know, different independent components, I would say, well, that's obvious. You know, we live in 2021 and the obvious solution to decomposing a monolith is to break it down into these things called microservices. But I understand that that's not the approach that you ended up taking. So can you talk about, you know, why you didn't follow kind of like the naive path of like, let's, you know, write a bunch of microservices, and what did you end up with instead? You know, what is kind of this modular monolith that you talk about?
Yeah, I mean, I think for one thing, we had been developing on Shopify Core for so long that pausing everything and building out net new microservices just wasn't feasible for us. Whereas the direction we ended up going was making incremental changes in the existing code base while teams continue to develop and add features to it. So that was a big reason. But the other thing is that unless we wanted to start from scratch to be able to start extracting some of these pieces out into microservices, we would need to have them well encapsulated and have boundaries in place, which is what we ended up doing. But we ended up deciding that we wanted to stop there because monoliths have a lot of pros, a lot of benefits. Having only one code base means you only have to do all of your gem bumps and your security fixes in one place.
Yeah.
It also means you only have to manage one deployment infrastructure and one test pipeline. There's also a lot less surface area in terms of like places that you could be attacked. And I think that makes the system a lot more resilient. And we found it helpful to keep all of our data in one place, in one database, and allow the different components to have access to the data that they needed instead of trying to synchronize it across many different systems.
Yeah.
And lastly, like with microservices, the communication between the different components has to happen over the network, which introduces a whole bunch of complexity around API version management and backwards compatibility, as well as just dealing with the network in general. It can be slow, you know, there's lots of ways it can fail. So those were all the things that we liked about the monolith and didn't want to just give those all up. And we kind of felt like moving to microservices was more of a topology change, whereas what we wanted was an architecture change. Like there was nothing necessarily wrong with our monolith. Yeah. It was just that there was no well-defined boundaries between different things.
So you had like this principled, thoughtful approach of, you know, we have developer pain, let's address that directly, but we're not going to convolve it with changing the topology of production, introducing all these unnecessary network boundaries, because that kind of introduces its own complexity and its own baggage in a way.
Yeah, exactly. Like our monolith had gotten us so far. We, I think, had learned so much about what is good about it that it gave us pause to really ask the question and really think it through about whether microservices were right for us. And the answer at the time was no. That being said, we are believers of service-oriented architecture.
Yeah.
So we do have other applications outside of the core code base. However, everything related to kind of the core functionalities of commerce, we keep in one place. But there have been some examples where we actually have extracted components out of the core code base because they weren't related to the core functionality of commerce and we pulled them out into their own services. Mm-hmm. But that was exponentially easier to do post-componentization.
So what did this modularization of the monolith, you know, actually entail? You know, I assume you started with knowledge of Ruby on Rails is fairly limited, but like I understand like the standard directory layout is you have a model directory, you have a view directory, you have a controller directory. Was that like the structure of the code base at the start of the project?
Yeah, that's correct. So we started before this, we basically just had a like Rails app out of the box. So you're exactly right. They were organized by our software concepts. But the first thing that we wanted to do was restructure a code base to be organized by real world concepts like mm-hmm. orders, shipping, inventory, billing. And what we ended up doing was we actually audited every single Ruby class in the code base, which was like 6,000 at the time, in a spreadsheet and manually labeled which component we thought that they belonged in based on the initial list of components we had. And then we built up one massive PR with automated scripts from the spreadsheet to basically just create those top level folders. And then within like the orders folder, within that, it would still be models, views, controllers, but we would just mm-hmm. move all of the specific models, views, and controllers into that folder. So we did that all in one big PR.
Got it.
Which was kind of terrifying, but ended up being fine. We have good test coverage, so it is.
What was the
good.
Size of that div? It must have been like.
It was like every file, like literally every file was touched. It was crazy. Wow. Yeah, so that was the first step.
Why wasn't that sufficient? You know, there's like, you know, the straw man is like, okay, we put everything in kind of its own directory. So now each team gets to work in their own directory and that's done. They're like separate code bases. Why was that not just the end of the project?
Well, I mean, all that had achieved was moving files around, right? Like in Ruby mm-hmm. on Rails, everything is automatically globally accessible. So just because all the code for orders was within an orders folder, it could still use whatever it wanted from any of the other folders.
Yeah.
So we still had all the same problems with like fragility of the test suite. And really, like if I was working in the orders component, I still had to understand about, say, the taxes component and the like shipping component because of how tightly coupled they were and how there was no clearly defined like API for them to communicate between the folders. They just like nothing had structurally changed about how the code was interacting. So it was a great first step in the sense that I now knew if I'm looking for something orders related, I can find it.
Yeah.
And that the top level component folders had explicit owners, which was actually like is a huge win.
Yeah.
But beyond that, we still hadn't solved a lot of the existing problems.
You mentioned something in your blog post about how like one of the initial pain points was as the code base grew, the amount of code that a given developer would have to understand to get a thing done was like something like O of N. Like it grew linearly with the size of the code base. And that obviously is untenable as you grow because it just means your productivity, I guess, approaches asymptotically down to zero. So how'd you go from O of N to, you know, sublinear? Like what were the things that you had to make in terms of code base structure to enable that?
Yeah, definitely. So once we moved all the code into their separate folders, the next ask was for each component to define a public API. And ideally that public API should be easy enough to understand that I can understand what it's doing without having to go under the hood and look into the component. And so that would allow me to get to know one component really well. We also asked each component to explicitly say which other components they depended on.
Mm-hmm.
So if, say, I was joining, like, again, the orders team, I could really deeply get to know the orders component. And then as my next step, I could look at what the dependencies listed out for the orders component is and maybe, like, just start by getting to know their public API so I know what methods are available to me from those components without needing to understand all the nuances of how they get the things done exposed in the public API.
Yeah. What about the human side of this kind of change? So, you know, in the organizations that we've worked with that have attempted something like this, there's the technical side, which involves making the proper changes to the code. In this case, I guess, like introducing a bunch of interfaces and making those interface boundaries well-defined. But then there's also this kind of human, semi-political aspect to it where, you know, you're going to each of these engineering teams and each of them have their own like goals and objectives that they're working toward, you know, business goals. And you're coming to them and essentially asking them to add work onto their plate to satisfy this change. you talk about like that element of it? Was, do you have to do like a lot of horse trading, or do me a favor, I'll do you a favor? Like, what does that, what does that look like from your perspective?
Yeah, it's interesting. I've actually talked about this project at like a few different conferences, and the two questions I always get are like, how did you get buy-in from the business to invest in this?
Yeah.
And how did you get buy-in from like the individual teams to invest in this? I guess there's no really easy answer or perfect way to do it, and it's going to be so nuanced depending on the organization that you're within. But one of Shopify's core cultural values that we're kind of taught from the beginning is build for the long term. And it's really driven home that like we're trying to build this business for 100 years, not for like 10 years. And so with that kind of mindset, it is easier to get buy-in for these kind of like short-term pain for long-term gain type projects. I think as well, like the developers that had been working in the core code base had all been feeling this pain, right? And so they were eager for opportunities to make it better and easier to develop within.
Yeah.
So it wasn't always easy. And to be honest with you, like different components are at completely different points in their componentization journey based on how well like their team has been able to prioritize this type of work.
Yeah.
One thing that we did was we built this tool called Wedge. A lot of complexity under the hood, but it basically gave components scores as to kind of how well they were doing on their componentization journey. And we kind of made it like a little fun competition between teams.
You gamified it. Like a,
exactly. Yeah. As a technical initiative that like the whole engineering org was working towards.
That's really interesting. So you kind of built a tool that condensed like all these complex refactorings into something that you could measure, like a numerical score, and that made it easier to track and also verify. How did you do that? Like, how do you convert like adding an interface or defining a good interface or, you know, eliminating a cyclical dependency or something into a number that is meaningful that, you know, the engineering teams don't shake their heads at, and that also is useful for tracking it at a top level?
Yeah, so Wedge was a really interesting tool. What we did was we used it to hook into Ruby Tracepoints during our test suite run to get a full call graph of all the calls that were being made as our code was being executed. And then we sorted the callers and callees by component and basically pulled out all of the calls that were happening across component boundaries and then sent them to Wedge. And we'd also send some other data like code analysis and active record associations and inheritance and such.
Yeah.
And then Wedge basically just went through everything that was sent to it and determined which of these things were okay and which ones were violating. So if a cross-component call was being made, if there was no dependency explicitly declared between those two components, it would be violating. And if it was anything other than the public interface, it would be violating. We actually found, though, that like it really is hard to get a number that is right, especially like with as much complexity as there is in call graph logging. So in the end, we actually ended up canning Wedge because we didn't find it to be a useful feedback cycle. And also mostly because we had to run the full test suite to get this feedback, and that takes way too long for it to be helpful.
Yeah.
So we ended up going in a different direction, but in the early days, it was really helpful to, like you said, kind of gamify it.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. As you kind of learn more about, you know, what was useful and productive, you know, what kind of stepped into the place that Wedge occupied? Was there like another tool that you used, or was there, you know, some different set of criteria that you use to gauge overall progress and success?
Yeah, we ended up building this tool called Packwork, which actually as of September of last year is open source. And it's a really cool tool that basically analyzes static constant references. So we found that there's like less ambiguity in static references. And because these references are always explicitly introduced by developers, it's more actionable to highlight them.
Yeah.
And it's much faster. So we're able to run a full analysis on our largest code base in a few minutes, which means that we can actually put it in as part of our pull request workflow, which is a way more helpful feedback loop for developers.
That's really interesting. So the Wedge was this dynamic tool. It kind of built up this like call graph or reference graph from runtime by observing what actually got called. And then Packwork was building up that graph, but statically based on like imports and references in source code. Is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. Like Pockwork uses the same assumptions as Zeitwork, which is the Rails code loader. And the way that Rails is able to make constants globally accessible is it basically infers the file location based on the constant's name. And we did the exact same thing with Pockwork.
So the, you know, programming languages part of my brain is saying like, but wait a minute, but Ruby is a dynamically typed language. You know, not all types are known at compile time. Were you able to solve that problem in Pockwork, like inferring types, or was it kind of like some element of like best effort, like this is good enough?
Yeah, 100% the latter. Like it is, we understand that it's an imperfect solution and there's a lot of crazy stuff that can happen in Rails that like will not be detected through this, but it's good enough. Essentially.
Yeah.
And it does catch a lot of things. So we decided that the fact that it can happen so much faster and provide that faster feedback loop is a trade-off we're willing to accept for the fact that, yes, maybe some things will slide under the radar.
I guess, you know, it's important to recognize that there's humans in the loop in this process. So in some sense, it'd be a much harder problem to completely automate it, right? Because then you'd have to get everything precise. But as long as there's humans in the loop, they can step in and say like, well, you know, we recognize this tool is a little bit fuzzy. As long as the signal to noise ratio is decently high, we can work with this.
Absolutely. And like the magic of this tool is not only within the tool itself, but it's within the conversations that it sparks. Because if on my PR, I get told like, oh, this is a cross component violation and maybe I don't know what that is, or maybe like I'm a more junior programmer and I don't have an idea of how to like do inversion of control, for example, like there's been a lot more conversations around software architecture across Shopify because of this tool. And so what that means is sometimes maybe the tool won't catch cross-component boundaries, but because it's now becoming a part of our engineering culture, maybe someone will in a PR review. And building that muscle of good software design really is kind of the overarching goal of this whole thing. So yes, the tool's not perfect, but it's been really valuable for us.
So you just mentioned inversion of control. And I think that along with some other things you called out in your blog post were kind of like good rules of thumb or good general principles that you kind of maybe discovered along the way of doing this. Can you talk about some of those principles or maybe like empirical patterns in terms of if someone were to attempt this on like a code base, a Rails code base in general, like what are kind of the maybe like tactical things? Is that the right tactical things that you can kind of tricks that you can apply to make the code base more decomposed and modular?
Yeah, I mean, I think the first thing I would say is that if someone's going to be trying this on a Rails code base, they'll probably be in a similar situation that we are or that we were, which is basically if you look at the dependency graph that has just like naturally happened, it's crazy. Like every component was basically depending on every other component. There's a ton of cyclic dependencies. Like Rails lends itself to naturally have high dependency. So I'll say that first. And even just being able to like visualize that dependency graph allows you to reason at a much higher level about like, does it make sense for this thing to depend on this thing? Sometimes it does and other times it doesn't. But when it doesn't, that's when you start to use some of these kind of tactical approaches for decoupling those things.
Yeah.
So I mentioned inversion of control, which basically is saying, so I'll give an example. I work on a product called the Shopify Fulfillment Network, where basically some merchants, we host their products on their behalf. And when orders come in, we'll choose the most optimal warehouse to fulfill it out of to get it to the buyer as quickly as possible. So SFN is, that's the acronym for the Shopify Fulfillment Network.
Yep.
It needs to know when an order comes in on a merchant store. And one way to do that could be for the orders component to make a call to a method in SFN and say like, new order has been created. And then SFN responds with like, great, we got it.
Yeah.
And so that's a hard dependency from the orders component to SFN.
Yep.
Whereas if we want to get rid of that dependency, we can actually just use a method like a publish subscribe mechanism. And there's a bunch of different ones to do that. But at Shopify, we use Kafka events a lot. And basically the orders component can just say like an order happened and then SFN can choose to subscribe to that and do its processing without needing to necessarily reply. And that has now broken that dependency between the two.
So it's kind of like at runtime, you want this one thing to provide behavior to this other thing that is going to run. But at compile time, you don't actually want an import going from that thing to this other thing, because that adds a hard dependency, and it means that someone working on the first thing will have to kind of go through the second thing and understand how it behaves. There's not this kind of like interface boundary that says like, okay, don't worry about the stuff behind this curtain.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And had there been a hard dependency, like say from the orders component to SFN, then the orders component would have to care every time SFN changed. And yeah. Now having done this inversion of control, it does not at all. It just has to fire its event.
Another thing that you talked about in the post was this kind of like loose coupling but high cohesion pattern that kind of got adopted. You mind explaining what that means?
Absolutely. Yeah, this was like one of the core principles of this project that we were striving towards. So coupling is basically like the level of dependency between modules or classes, or in this case, components.
Yeah.
And so you want that to be low because you want your dependency graph to be as light as possible. But you want the cohesion to be high. And the cohesion is basically the measure of how much elements within a certain encapsulation belong together. So mm-hmm. whether you're looking at a module level, a class level, or the package level. And one thing to note is like, it's really hard to get the component interface right when the classes within it have interfaces that are not well-defined, and the modules within it. Like, it really starts with good software design from the bottom up, and that makes it easier, a lot easier to get the component interfaces right.
Yeah.
And then on the point of cohesion, there's kind of two different types of cohesion that we think about. The first is functional cohesion. So that basically means code that performs the same task lives together. So you can kind of think of like service objects as being functionally cohesive, whereas data or informational cohesion is code that operates on the same object living together. Hmm. And again, Rails really lends itself to data or informational cohesion mm-hmm. because of the way that active record models are built up to interact with one database model. We often add a lot of methods relating to that object on its model, even though they might be parts of completing completely different tasks. So mm-hmm. I'm sure different languages kind of lend themselves to different ones, but we found ourselves way over skewed in the direction of data and informational cohesion.
So, you know, where is this project today? You mentioned it started in 2017 and it's been a multi-years long effort. Are things still being componentized in the main Rails code base? Or at this point, has it been componentized and it's more or less in a done state? You just have to maintain the status quo.
I wish I could tell you we're in a done state, but the reality is that we're not. All of the code has been moved into components, and all of the components do have publicly defined entry points.
Yeah.
But the reality was that we were starting from a place where a lot of these calls were already violating the rules.
Yeah.
And so one of the nice features that Packwork built was that you could essentially declare bankruptcy and start from a certain point and only start tracking violations beyond that. Mm. So we have a list of deprecated references, and the rule is basically that you can't add any new violations. We know that there are some existing ones, but no new ones can be added. And over time, that deprecated references list basically gives us like a tech debt to-do list to work off of. And so, like I said, like different components are kind of in different shape, but we haven't yet gotten to the point where all of those violations are gone. And only once all of those violations are gone will we be able to actually enforce those boundaries.
Fascinating. So, you know, you have this kind of like list of tech debt to-do items. In a given, you know, iteration cycle, how do you decide how many of those to tackle versus how many, I guess, like more product oriented things to tackle? Because like that's something that our teams at Sourcegraph, I assume like probably any software team struggles with, right? Like, what is the right balance of like tech debt versus you know, new feature development to take on?
Yeah.
Like, can you put a price on a tech debt item? It's like almost an impossible exercise.
Yeah, no, it's really a hard question. And it's honestly, the answer is going to be different team to team at Shopify.
Yeah.
One of the kind of patterns that I've seen in my years at Shopify is that we build a lot of features. We move really quickly leading up to Black Friday and Cyber Monday, because that's when our merchants make the vast majority of their sales for the year. And so it's really important that we've given them the tools that they need to be successful during that time. But come the holiday season, we actually tend to cool down a bit on feature development, just because we don't want to be breaking things when our merchants are having their most important sales of the year.
Yeah.
And so often that kind of feature cool down can be a good time to tackle some of these larger units of tech debt. That said, I'm not saying that we just like leave tech debt to do like at one point in the year. We definitely try to find some pause between projects or even just like parallel tracks of work where some people are working on more technical debt and some people are working on product features. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely a hard balance, but we have been slowly chipping away at it.
So I understand that the Shopify Fulfillment Network, which you mentioned earlier, that's kind of this separate code base. And it also is or was a Rails monolith, and that you're kind of currently tackling a similar project in that code base, but kind of adjusting some things based on what you've learned from this first, you know, major decomposition componentization effort. So
exactly.
Tell me about, you know, round two, you know, what's different this time in the sequel?
Yeah, we actually took a pretty different philosophical approach. So like what we did in core was we moved all of the code into the components and then slowly over time started trying to break some of those dependencies. Hmm. Whereas what we've done in the Shopify Fulfillment Network was we've introduced separate components and we've actually used Rails engines, which are like the one modularity feature that come out of the box with Rails.
Yeah.
And that can allow us to enforce those boundaries a little bit more strictly. And then over time, piece by piece, moved bits of code into it that are always respecting the boundaries. So we kind of flipped it on its head that way. Whereas we still do have the main like app controllers, models, et cetera.
Yeah.
But the hard rule is we can't add any more code into the app folder. All new code goes into component folders. And over time, we're pulling code from the app folder out into its basically correct component so that anything that's in a component is respecting the component boundaries, whereas that is not the case in core.
Interesting. So with core, the approach was move all the files around into their appropriate directories and then over time reduce the linkedness or monolithicness of each component. Whereas with fulfillment, you basically said, keep the existing monolith as is, but each new feature has to be added to something that's external in like a Rails engine. And then we'll have some connection between the two so that the functionality makes it into the application. But we always preserve this, like, I guess, invariant of all the new components are modularized. Is that
Yeah, about that's right? And the kind of one of the main benefits of that is that with so many developers working in a code base, people tend to want to follow the patterns that they see existing.
Yeah.
And in core, there's a mix of good patterns and bad patterns because some stuff has been adjusted to break that interdependency and some stuff hasn't.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to know like which pattern to follow, like which way is the right way when there are both examples.
Yeah.
Whereas in SFN, anything that's in that has been componentized is following the patterns that we're wanting to kind of strive for.
Yeah.
So there's more good examples to be able to learn from and demonstrate to other developers and follow.
I get all the like learnings here. This is like really fantastic insight. One thing I'd love to hear about is like, what is the process like on the ground that you arrive at these insights? You know, like, oh, you know, for this new project, we don't want to, you know, move a bunch of stuff in the existing code base around, but we want to start with something new, or, you know, moving from the dynamic dependency call graph to the static version. What are those conversations like? Is it, you know, you and a bunch of other engineers or engineering managers in a room like whiteboarding, or someone come up with kind of like a bright idea and slowly convince other people? What are there any like, you know, I guess like war stories that come to mind when you kind of like reach these insights?
Yeah, it's always like a conclusion that we come to kind of over time. Like in the example of Wedge, it was working well for a while, but over time, the problems with it became louder and louder and louder until we couldn't ignore them. So like with that one, it was really as our test suite was getting larger and slower, it was really just that it wasn't a helpful feedback loop to have to wait for that entire test suite to run to be able to get that insight.
Yeah.
And so we knew there was a problem with that, but then the question is like, what's the solution? So we have a few different avenues for kind of like brainstorming these ideas. One is actually like a team whose mandate is architecture patterns. Hmm. And they're the ones that built Packwork and provided a lot of the patterns to follow. And so sometimes it's just like projects that get resourced, and we do like kind of explore and prototype phases. And so like being armed with the learnings from Wedge, it kind of led us down the road to Packwork.
Yeah.
But the other thing is we have a software architecture guild at Shopify, which is basically anyone from the company who's interested in software architecture. We have a Slack channel and a biweekly meetup. Mm. And that's where a lot of these conversations kind of come to a head, because I think there were a lot of learnings from core, but then, for example, like the developers who were starting to build out SFN may not have had access to that frontline information. And so we try to, like, we did a lot of pairing actually as a way to share this knowledge and have a lot of discussions at the Architecture Guild. Cause like Shopify is very, I guess each team has a lot of autonomy. So, you know, the SFN team had the autonomy to decide what the right solution for it was, but definitely wanted to leverage the learnings that were present from core. Yeah. So that's the type of discussion that like we would have at an architecture guild, or we also do technical design reviews for any like big tech projects we're kicking off.
Yeah.
So like that would be another, we have templates for those, and we kind of have filled those templates with some prompting questions to try to make people think about modularization as part of the upfront design.
Interesting. Tell me more about this guild. So, you know, what is a guild exactly? Is it just a collection of individuals who have kind of a common technical interest area, or like, how is it organized? Is there like a process associated with it? How does it fit into the like overall org structure of the engineering team?
Yeah, it doesn't fit into the org structure of the engineering team. Like it's composed of people from across everywhere in the engineering org. It's completely opt-in, and it kind of grew organically from people who were curious to be having conversations like this.
Yeah.
I think one big learning actually that my coworker Philip called out in his blog post was that he wished that we had started this sooner in the componentization process, so more minds could have been kind of involved and had buy-in basically for them to apply the approach that we're aligning upon in their different areas of the company. Mm-hmm. But it really is just people that want to nerd out about software architecture, and people come with like presentations every other week. Sometimes we'll just share like the architecture of one of our systems. Sometimes we'll have more pointed discussions about like certain software design strategies. It's pretty organic, but it people like it.
That's awesome. So the guild kind of formed after the start of the original project.
Yeah, that's right.
At what stage do you think it makes sense to form a guild? Or is like, I think that it, like we run into the same issue. And I think a lot of other engineering organizations run into this issue where you have your org chart and you try your best to produce an org chart that reflects the needs of the product and, you know, how knowledge and information needs to flow. But no chart is ever going to be perfect. And there's all these kind of areas of expertise that don't neatly fit into that. And I guess the question in my mind has always been, at what point do you start to need kind of these like guild structures? Like, is it at like 100 engineers? Is that like 1,000 engineers? Or, you know, what in your mind is the right size?
Yeah, we've actually experimented with like a few different things. The guild is more of like a meetup. We less like drive change through the guild, I would say, other than like grassroots movements. But we also have what we call a technical leadership team, which is on a rotational basis. Leaders from like technical leaders from across the company will be on that team. And anytime we're doing a tech design review, like you'll get paired up with someone from the technical leadership team. You can bring them your like gnarliest problems. And it's made up of people from all different parts of the org with all different perspectives on the problem. So it's kind of a way to try to, I guess, make sure that we're leveraging the learnings that are available at the company level. And then there's also what we were chatting about before, like the tools and patterns team. And their actual mandate and what they work on day in, day out is building out some of these tools and patterns. And I think I would guess that team spun up probably in like 2018, just based on this project having started in 2017.
Yeah.
And yeah, we were probably 500 to 600 engineers around then. It's going to be like different for every organization. And I think it depends on how much your organization already has it baked into their DNA to be thinking about these things, to be thinking about good software design, technical initiatives, et cetera, or not. Yeah. Sometimes it might make sense to start earlier if that's not as organically present. There's trade-offs to each approach. Like one of the challenges that the tools and patterns team has is that they're just building tools and patterns, right? But they aren't necessarily using those tools and patterns to build product. So they need to make sure that they are in touch with the people that are using those tools and patterns and actually solving the right problems. And so we do that through like pairing and internal documentation, presentations, et cetera. But we really try to make sure that it's like the problems that need to be solved are being solved. And we're not just adding friction to developers' lives because we think it's nicer.
Yeah, that makes a ton of sense. Kind of, you know, looking back on like both projects that you've been involved in with decomposition, to what extent are the patterns that you discovered, do you think, specific to, you know, those particular code bases? And to what extent do you feel like, you know, there's some like general principles here that would be widely applicable? Or that's one question. More proximal question would be, you know, the way that you're approaching modularization on the fulfillment network code base, do you wish that you had done that with the main code base initially, like knowing what you know now? Or do you think that each code base found its kind of like proper approach?
Yeah, it's a challenging question because they both have their trade-offs, right? So I think that you just need to know in your situation which trade-offs you're willing to accept. Mm-hmm. For the Shopify core case, what we were really struggling with and really wanting to optimize for was that we had a lot of code that didn't have ownership. And so having moved the code into folders that have explicit owners is a big win for that. Whereas in SFN, we still have a lot of code living in the app component that doesn't have as clear owners. But for us, that's okay because it's a smaller group of people working on it. And mm-hmm. so it's easier to kind of share the load across our team, which is smaller. Whereas for core, it was really important that we get it right in terms of code ownership. So I think you really have to ask yourself, like, what is the intermediate state that you're most comfortable with? Because these things take a long time, right? And so I think like Philip has an amazing quote in his blog post. He says, "My experience tells me that temporary incomplete state will at least last longer than you expect. So choose an approach based on which intermediate state is most useful for your situation." And it's 100% true in this case. Like both of those code bases are in intermediate states that are correct for them. And I think you just need to think about what that means for your code base.
Yeah, that's very fair. You know, somewhere out there, there's a person listening who wants to propose big refactoring re-architecture project. But, you know, you often run into resistance from other stakeholders in the business because the value of such a project is not always clear. What advice would you have for people in that position, just kind of in the very early stages of thinking through starting such a project and getting organizational buy-in?
Yeah. One thing that I think about often as it relates to this is, I don't know if you're familiar with like Martin Fowler's design stamina hypothesis, but it basically says that...
I read that because your post, but
I love it. I talk about it all the time. It basically says that like in the beginning, no design is actually the best design and you'll be able to move more quickly without design.
Yeah.
But at some point, you're going to reach a point where not having a design is going to slow you down more and more and more, and adding incremental functionality just gets harder and harder. So the first question that I would ask is like, are we past that point? He calls it the design payoff line. Like, are we really at a point where we need this design? Because honestly, it's worse to have a bad design than to have no design, in my opinion. So you want to make sure that you like have enough information and have built enough features to understand what design your code base needs. So that's the first thing. But if you think that you are in that position, I always find that the business and like product managers are very motivated by data. So the more data that you can capture, the better. So I don't know, like if at your organization you use story points, but say you could point to like an issue of story point 3 used to take half a day. Now it takes a day and a half. Like anything that you can point to show that is actually that you are getting slower is a really good starting point. Often they will have been feeling similar things. Like it probably won't come out of left field to them. They might feel like projects are taking longer than they should and are harder than they should. So the more like you socialize the idea of the X would be easier if we did this, and like really just keep being the squeaky wheel.
Yeah.
That can be really helpful. The other thing too is like, we would absolutely never have gotten buy-in to stop feature development and do this, right? So if you can do it in an incremental way that you can chip away at over time, it'll be mm-hmm. much more likely that you can get buy-in. And if you're in the lucky situation where your company has enough engineers to be working on parallel tracks of work, then if some people can still be building features while some people do this, it's going to be a lot easier of a pill to swallow for the business.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Kirsten, thanks so much for taking the time today. If there's people listening to this and they're interested in learning more about this effort, or you know, more about you know, projects and learnings that you've undertaken, you know, where should they go on the internet to find out more and learn more?
Well, Shopify has an engineering blog where we've published a few different blog posts on this topic. So I would definitely start with checking those out. We also have a Ship It Presents new YouTube series about some of the engineering efforts at Shopify. And there's an episode that speaks about this as well. So check those out. And there's lots of other interesting non-componentization related stuff on the Shopify engineering blog. So I would say give that a look.
All right. My guest today has been Kirsten Westeinde. Kirsten, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks for having me. It was fun.
The Sourcegraph podcast is a production of Sourcegraph, the universal code search engine, which gives you fast and expressive search over the world of code you care about. Sourcegraph also provides code navigation abilities like jump to dev and references in code review, and integrates seamlessly with your code host, whether you're working in open source or on a big, hairy enterprise code base. To learn more, visit sourcegraph.com. See you next time.